I have made this polyethylene gear on the mill and on the lathe. I make this gear using a fly cutter. I can make this fly cutter on the mill and on the lathe. I made this HPL gear on the mill and on the lathe using the same cutter. I made this helical gear on my CNC lathe. To make it, I made this end mill style cutter on the mill. To make my cutters on the lathe, I use this tool and a standard cutting tool. To make the fly cutter on the mill, I use a vise and this tapered drill, cone drill, sheet drill, however you call it. To make the end mill style cutter on the mill, I use a vise and this center drill. It is not complicated and I'm going to show you how. These form cutters are made using the button method. I think the button method is invented by Even Law, but I'm not sure. The use of a cone drill was introduced by John Stevenson in 1910. I am going to show you in 3 days how this button method functions. And for the calculations, I have prepared a Excel sheet that you can use. Links to the 3-day and the Excel sheet are in the description of the video. Let's start by explaining how the button method works. The button method is probably made by Even Law. He has written a book about gears and gear cutting. And that is really worthwhile reading. In the description of the video, there is a link to this book. I have drawn a 28-tooth involute gear. And I have drawn the gear cutter made using the button method. If when we zoom in and we see this edge, and this green edge is the shape of the involute tooth. This edge is the shape of the gear cutter made using the button method. It is a radius, and when you look closely, you see that this cutter cuts away a bit more than it should. If you compare what is cut away too much to the tooth width, it is neglectable. If you use a number one cutter that is designed for a 12 teeth gear, and you use it to cut a 13-teeth gear, you introduce the same problem. By making your gear cutters specific for the number of teeth of the gear, you can reduce this error pretty much. Cutting a bit too much results in a bit more play, but the gear will mesh, and that bit of extra play is neglectable in most situations. This is the gear made using the button method. In the button method, this radius is cut by a round piece of steel, the so-called button. To cut this profile, the buttons need to have a certain diameter. This is called the button diameter. These two buttons must be at the correct distance. The heart-to-heart distance of these buttons is called the button separation. And you have to feed in these buttons the correct distance. The distance is measured from the tip of the button and is called the infeed. These three values can be calculated. You can use the spreadsheet to calculate these values. The use of the spreadsheet will be explained in the next chapter. This is the spreadsheet I use for
making gear cutters and gears. You should only change the blue values. It always starts by entering the pressure angle, the module, and the number of teeth. Then your button diameter, your button separation, and your infeed is calculated, so you can use that for milling or turning your gear cutter. If you make an end mill style gear cutter, you can set the diameter of the end mill you use to mill the tip, and it calculates the infeed for the tapered drill. If you want to cut a gear, you can use the outside diameter and the cutting depth. On the right, you find the calibration of the tapered drills. I have set up 2 shoot drills, 2 center drills, and 1 countersink. To calibrate the sheet drill, you need 2 calibration points because the angle isn't known. For the center drill and the countersink, you only need 1 calibration point. A calibration point is a diameter and a height. If you fill in these values, then the height to get the correct button diameter is calculated. In the next chapter, I'll show you how to calibrate your tapered drills.
We are going to calibrate the tools. I use this 3 to 14 millimeter cone drill and this center drill. We start by using the center drill. I prepared a calibration tool. A piece of scrap, a hole of 5, 10 and 12 millimeters. You place the tip of the center drill on the calibration tool. We zero the dial and we measure how deep it goes to reach the 10 millimeter hole, 9.07 millimeters. This has to be done only once, and we repeat the procedure for the sheet drill. Place it on top, zero the dial, 6.77 millimeters. The 12 millimeter hole .13 millimeters. Because we don't know the taper of the cone drill, we need 2 measurements. The taper of the center drill is 60 degrees, so we can calculate the taper. Now we fill in these values in the spreadsheet, and then we are ready to make a spur gear cutter. The first cutter we make will be a file cutter, the second will be a milling cutter.
This is the design of the fly cutter made using my smallest sheet drill. If you look at the side, you can see it has a clearance angle. If we draw our arbor and cutting radius, we can check if this clearance angle is large enough. The small circle is my arbor, and the large circle is the cutting radius. As you can see, the clearance angle is enough.
We are going to mill a fly cutter using a tapered drill. The arbor is a piece of hex steel, an 8 millimeter hole, and 2 grub screws on top, so that I can clamp it on the sides. The grub screw is on the end flat, so it will hold better. The tool bit, 8 millimeter round steel, and I already milled a flat. I've placed a vice stop we have to mill down half the diameter. The diameter is 8, so there should be left 4 millimeters. So we have to mill down 3.43 millimeters. End mill registered on the milled flat. You're going to mill about 10 millimeters. I have placed the cone drill, and the first thing we do is grind the tip and of course set the height. The arbor is 17 millimeters, so I'm going to set my Y position in mid of the arbor. That is my first reference. I place the tip over the sheet drill on the cutting edge and zero my dowel. That is the reference position Z. Then I lower the sheet drill 20.08 millimeters . That is reference Z. Then I flip the tool bit so that we get a nice clearance angle. And now I'm going to mill the tip. All black has gone. We start milling at the front side, then we mill the tip, and then we mill the back side. So we have less burrs. I set the cutting depth in X 0.0. That is my reference position in X. Then I feed in X. The infeed for this button, 4.04 millimeters. Lock the table. And I feed in Z, half the button separation. I go to my 0.X. Lock the table. I go to the other side. And this will cut the front of the tip. I stop at half the button separation. And now I feed in an X, the infeed of 4.04 millimeters. That's it. This is the result. As you can see, clearance on the tip and burrs. We can remove the burrs by just peeling them off by hand. And stone or grind the flat, or we can just mill the flat a few thousandths down. But I think it's good enough without doing anything.
This is the model of the end mill style gear cutter. This is the cutting edge. When we look on top, this is the cutting edge. The green circle is the cutting radius. And you can see that part of the cutting edge is outside the cutting radius. This means that the selected taper is too small. In the cut spreadsheet, I have selected taper 1. That is my smallest taper. And I change it to 2. The model is recalculated based on this taper. Now you see the green cutting edge is within the cutting radius. This cutting edge should normally end in the center of the cutter. That would make this tip very weak. So I don't cut to the center of the cutter, but I keep the distance from the center to this cutting edge 20% of the width of the cutter tip. This cutter tip is on top totally flat. That means there is no relief angle. It is only 0.8 millimeters thick. So it's difficult to grind a relief angle. So I leave it as is. And in plastics and HPL, it doesn't matter. If you need a relief angle, you can mill a relief angle on the tip the same way you do when milling a fly cutter.
We are going to make an end mill style gear cutter, like this one. For this we need a center drill. I have an arbor, a piece of hex steel, an 8mm hole and 2 grub screws on top, a tool bit, 8mm round steel. I have a vice top that makes it easier to change the position of the arbor. We start by milling the tip of the tool bit flat. This is done and now we set the reference position in the X direction. So I zero my dial. Then I position my end mill in the center of the arbor. Then I zero my dial. So my reference in Y direction is also set. Now we can set the height. Then we'll on the tool bit, zeroing the dial. Now my Z position is set. This will be the cutting edge that has the shape of the tooth profile. We are milling a cutting edge at the center of the tool bit. So the cutting depth will be 4 millimeters. Ideally, we would mill exactly on the center of the tool bit. But to give the small tip a bit more twanged, we position the tool bit at 0.18 millimeters of the center of the tool bit. That is 1/5 of the width of the gear cutter. So we move the end mill half the diameter plus 0.18 millimeters. That is 3.18 millimeters. And we lock the table. Now we can mill the flute. We're going to mill the flute about 10 millimeters long. Now we're going to rotate the arbor 120 degrees so we can make a free flute end mill. I've made a mark. So it is easier to identify the right position. And now we can mill the next flute. We're going to change the tool for the center drill. We place the tip of the center drill on the cutting edge and zero the dial. We're going to flip the arbor. Now the unmarked position will be on top. This side, the bottom side, is the cutting edge, so we have to cut on this side. We move the center drill to the infeed position. We move the center drill to half the button separation. That is 5.19 millimeters. And we can lock the table. To get the correct button diameter, we have to lower the center drill 8.0 millimeters. We have set the reference in X direction using a 6 millimeter end mill. The infeed for this gear cutter is 4.04 millimeters. We have to correct this infeed because we have set the zero position using a 6 millimeter end mill. And the center drill diameter is 9.56 millimeters. So we have to feed in 4.04 millimeters plus half the diameter of the end mill minus half the diameter of the center drill. So we have to feed in 2.26 millimeters. Let's cut the flutes. The first fluting is done. We're going to rotate the arbor to cut the other flutes. Remember, the unmarked flutes on top. This is how it looks. Most of the burrs you can move by your fingernails. This is the result.
We are now going to turn a fly cutter on the lay. To give the cutting edge of the fly cutter clearance, I use a spacer. The spacer is placed on top of the arbor and held by the two top claws. The tool bit is rotated 30 degrees and is aligned with the back claw. The blue circle is the toolpath when making the gear cutter. The green circle is the toolpath when we are cutting a gear. As you can see, there is clearance. I can't turn a radius on my lay manual, but I can do it CNC. So I turn the radius CNC.
In this video, I'm going to show you how to make a spur gear cutter using the lay. I use the button method to make cutters, and I'm going to make a module 1 cutter, 20 degree pressure angle for 28 teeth. I have an arbor, nothing more than an 8 diameter hole. Room for a grub screw on this side and a grub screw on this side. I use a grub screw with a flat end. I prepared the tool bit off camera. I turned away half a millimeter. This flat is used to hold the grub screw. excellent finish. You place the tool bit, the grub screw on front, and the cutting edge towards you. Use the spacer on top, clamped by both top claws. Rotate the tool bit so that it aligns with the back claw. To turn the left and right cutting edge, I use this tool, and I can use one tool to cut both sides. I make the tip black, and we first turn the tip. Excellent finish, and all the black has gone. Excellent finish. Then we turn the other side. Also excellent finish, and the cutter hasn't moved. I mark this cutter black, no burrs, excellent finish. I'm going to harden one of my tool bits, the one I made on the lathe, to protect the tool against the heat. You can use borax or soap. You can warm the tool bit and press it in a piece of soap, or you can use that soft soapy material and give it a coating. I have a propane torch, but any torch would do. We're going to heat it up, and we quench it in water. Quenching in water makes this steel the hardest. We're going to heat. When the steel is warm enough, it won't attract this magnet. I will zoom in and lighten the torch. The orange flame is caused by the soap. It takes about 2 minutes to heat up. it's hot enough. I will stop the flame and immediately quench it in water. During quenching, I will stir a bit. It only takes seconds to cool down. This is how it looks. The tip is black. I will clean it off camera. But most part is nicely protected by the soap. There are still some black spots. There's not burnt metal, but burnt soap. Then we can test the hardness by using a file. That is pretty hard.
Before we going to mill a gear, we approach a key way so that we can take the gear blank off the mill to do a test fit. The key way ensures we can place it back the same way.
I'm going to broach a keyhole in the gear blank. To support the gear blank during broaching, I place adjustable stop. It's made of wood, so even if there are chips in the spindle, that won't hurt. For broaching, I use this tool. It is made of silver steel. The tip is grinded. And these sides are parallel. So no clearance. Due to these parallel sides, I don't need to lock my chuck when broaching. Once the first pass is done, these sides will keep the chuck always in the same position. There's a small angle on the tip, 3 degrees, and that's just enough for clearance. I use the CNC to broach, but you can do it also by hand. I take shallow cuts, 0.15 millimeters. The keyhole is 3 millimeters, so I need 1.5 millimeters and 0.1 millimeter for clearance. You can see the key, and it takes some effort. but it fits. I'm going to show you how I cut my gears on the mill. It starts by aligning the rotary table. I have two magnets, one on the rotary table and one on my mill. The mill on this side is flat, and I can place an alignment tool between. Check. The rotary table is aligned and I can tighten the nuts. I use the same procedure for aligning my vise. I have a stepper on my rotary table that is turning the knob. On this side I have a pneumatic cylinder that can lock the table by pulling on the clamp. I have a control box. That rotates to the next step, unlocks the table, and when done positioning, locks the table. So I don't forget to lock the table anymore, I hope. I have an arbor, and on the arbor there is a key. When I'm done cutting the gear, I can take it off and do a test fit. If the gear doesn't fit, I can always place the gear in the same position due to the key and adjust my cutting depth. That only works when I start at the same position. To start at the same position, I can use the dial or do a homing, because on the back I have mounted a sensor that I use for repositioning my rotary table. We start by mounting the gear. We then set the first position by homing the rotary table. Then one position forward, that is to avoid backlash. Now we have to set the cutting height. The hole for the tool bit is 8 mm from the edge of the arbor. When I place the arbor on the gear blank and reset my dial, I have to lower the tool bit 8 mm to be aligned with the top of my gear blank. My gear blank is 30 mm in diameter, so I have to lower my z-axis 15 mm plus 8 mm, 23 mm. And I can lock my z-axis. We now have to set the x-axis. I rotate my spindle and move the cutter towards the gear blank until it touches the blank. You hear it? That is my zero point for the cutting depth. I can reset my x-axis and then I can move to the cutting depth of 2.16 mm and lock the table. I know that because my mill isn't rigid, I normally have to cut a bit deeper. So I cut 0.1 mm deeper and I know that my gear will be okay. Then we have to position the x-axis so that when the spindle is turning, it doesn't touch the gear blank. This is our retract position. I can now zero my y-axis and we can start cutting our first gear. I cut softer gear blanks in one pass. If you don't do that, then the teeth will bend due to the cutting forces and you don't get a good tooth profile. By cutting the whole profile at full cutting depth, the part of the gear blank that isn't cut keeps the teeth together. If you are cutting aluminum or steel, then you can use shallow cuts. I have fitted the fly cutter that we made using the sheet drill. I mark the last tooth cut. This is how it looks like. Always check the thickness of your last two teeth. They should be equal. And this polyethylene takes a lot to clean up. This is a Module 1 gear, 35 teeth, and it feels okay. And it looks okay. So this gear is a success. I have placed the gear cutter we made on the lathe marked black. The gear blank is made of HPL for our Dutch viewers, Trespa. And I placed two blanks behind each other. We followed the same procedure. We place the arbor on the gear blank, zero the dial. And then we lower 8 millimeters for the arbor and 15 for the gear blank. And we can lock the Z-axis. Then we find our X position. We zero our X dial. Then we move the feed in 2.16 millimeters, and to compensate for the flex in my mill, I move in 0.1 millimeter extra. Then I lock my x-axis. We find a position where the cutter doesn't touch the blank anymore. One rotation extra, and we zero the y dial. We move one index back. And then one index up to remove the backlash. And now we can start cutting our gear. I run at 1200 RPM and feed in as fast as I can. Stop feeding in when the tool doesn't touch the blank anymore. Back to our zero position. And the next index. Mark the last tooth. The back is all right, except for these teeth. And if you look at the blank, you see there was a hole in the blank. And so does it look if you don't use a protective blank at the back. The teeth look good. This is one of the polyethylene gears I have cut. And a teeth mesh. This gear is for my lathe, my small lathe. They mesh, they fit nice, no gap, no play. Good result. This is my milling spindle for on the lathe. I use the Dremel. And I have attached a collet holder, an ER11 collet holder. That is large enough to fit my 6mm cutters. I have added 2 7000 AC contact angle bearings because the bearings of the Dremel aren't accurate enough. I can take it off. It's a screw-on solution. There's a small adapter inside that fits the nut for my Dremel. The black adapter is 3D printed and can be switched for another adapter to fit another motor. This 4250 Dremel should be better than my 3000 Dremel. It has a bit more torque, 25%, but there is no speed regulation. When I switch on at 5000 RPM, I can stop the spindle by hand. Feedback means RPM, idle and under load should be the same. But it is not. We are going to cut a helical gear. 28 teeth, 25 degrees helix angle, module 1. The cut went well, but as always, POM takes a lot of cleaning. I have removed the burrs using a brush. As you can see, the teeth bottoms are very good. I can see some marks from scatter. So the next time I have to reduce the feed rate a bit. The gear on the right is 3D printed. As you can see, the teeth match well. Overall, I am very happy with the result. In this last video, I show you the milling of an aluminium gear using a end mill style cutter. I have made this cutter from silver steel and hardened it off camera. I am milling this gear using the Dremel 4250.
I'm running at 15,000 RPM and a feed rate of 150 millimeters a minute. I have already cut almost the whole gear of camera using cutting depth of 0.2 millimeter. I only recorded the last two full cycles, one at a cutting depth of 0.2 millimeter and the finish pass at a cutting depth of 0.06 millimeters.
We do the final cycle at a cutting depth of 0.06 millimeters. This is one of the gears we made. They mesh. No play. I consider this a success. Testing gears. To test gears, I use a plate on the back, holes with a countersink at different distances. These are two gears from my mini lay that are change gears. They just fit. For the gears we have made, I've made a test plate, heart to heart distance 28 millimeters. They mesh, they turn. So these are okay. The right one is the we made, the left one is 3D printed, and as you can see, they also turn easily. The last gear we test is the aluminium gear made on the lay. It just isn't good enough. It turns, but there isn't enough play. If you look good, you see that the aluminium tooth tip has some play in the plastic gear, the white gear. But the plastic tooth tip, the white tooth tip, has no play. So I didn't cut the aluminium gear deep enough. So the next time I need to cut 0.1 millimeter deeper and then it's okay. I can make my own gear cutters and gears thanks to Even Law, who invented the button method. John Stevenson, who came up with the idea to use a tapered drill. Mike's workshop that has a lot of information about gears and gear cutting, and a lot of videos on YouTube. I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something. If so, give me a thumbs up. Thank you for watching.